Al-insanu lil-jins, anna al-nasa fi khusran min tijaratihim. First, al-insan lil-jins. That this word insan is referring to all human beings. So when Allah says the human being is no doubt in deep trouble, in deep loss, there is no exception. Because the jins in Arabic means the entire category. There, no one should think when they read the ayah, not me, somebody else. I can think of my neighbor, I can think of these other kuffar that are in trouble. That's not the idea when you use the word jins. It is a universal statement. Then the second, we read this in Zamakhshari also, أَنَّ النَّاسَ فِي خُسْرَانٍ مِنْ تِجَارَتِهِمْ إِلَّا الصَّالِحِينَ وَحْدَهُمْ. That people are in tremendous loss because of the trades they make. In other words, they put their money and their effort and their time into things that they think will bring them profit, but they bring them nothing but loss. إِلَّا الصَّالِحِينَ, except for the righteous, وَحْدَهُمْ, them alone. May Allah make us from them. لِأَنَّهُمْ اشْتَرَوا الْآخِرَةَ بِالدُّنْيَا. Because those are the people, which trade did they do? They purchased the akhirah in exchange for giving up the pleasures of dunya. That's the transaction that the salihin made. فَرَبِحُوا وَسَعِدُوا. That then they were profitable and they were happy. وَمَنْ عَدَاهُمْ تَجَرُّوا خِلَافَ تِجَارَتِهِمْ. And then whoever was an enemy against them, who stood against this transaction of theirs, فَوَقَعُوا فِي الْخَسَارَ وَالشَّقَاوَى. Then they remained in loss and in despair. Then we read something from Ash-Shawkani, وَالْمَعْنَى أَنَّ كُلَّ إِنسَانٍ فِي الْمَتَاجِرِ وَالْمَسَاعِي. Beautiful words. He says that this means that every human being is in an act of selling and trading and making efforts constantly. Meaning they're competing in making more sales than the other, and they're competing in getting ahead from the other. This is what they're lost in. And if you remember, this is very similar to what we talked about in At-Takathur. His tafsir of this word is very similar to what we already read in At-Takathur. وَصَرَفَ الْأَعْمَارُ فِي أَعْمَالِ الدُّنْيَا. And he exhausts his ages. By أَعْمَار, he's referring to his age, meaning youth is one age, maturity is one age, you know, middle age is one age, then old age and senility. He exhausts all of his life opportunities in the works of dunya, lafi nuqs, and all of them that have been exhausted. وَصَرْفُ أَعْمَارٍ فِي أَعْمَالِ الدُّنْيَا لَفِي نُقْس. They are all in loss. وَضَلَال, and in waste. عَنِ الْحَقْ حَتَّى يَمُوتْ. And he's misled from the truth until he dies, and then he wakes up. وَقِيلَ الْمُرَادْ بِالْإِنسَانَ الْكَافِرِ. We talked about this before, but it's coming up directly from the Mufassiruna. It has also been said that the insan in this surah refers to the kafir. That the meaning of al-insan, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ. Some have understood this as إِنَّ الْكَافِرَ لَفِي خُسْرِ. وَقِيلَ جَمَاعَةٌ مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ. It's also been said it's a group from the kuffar. وَهُمُ الْوَلِيدُ بِنْ الْمُغِيرَةِ وَالْعَاصِ بِنْ وَائِلٍ وَالْأَسْوَدُ بِنْ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ بِنْ أَسَدٍ. Others say that no, this is a group from the kuffar, specifically in the life of the Prophet, like Walid ibn Mughira, As ibn Wail, Aswad ibn Abdul Muttalib. These are the kinds of individuals, la'anahumullah, that are being referred to in this surah. But even Ash-Shawkani rahimahullah says, but the first meaning is preferred among these who say they are kuffar. The ones who generally refer to the kuffar is the preferred meaning. But then even that has a criticism which we'll get to. وَقَالَ الْأَخْفَشْ فِي خُسْرٍ فِي هَلَكَ. Al-Akhfash rahimahullah says, when Allah says fi khusr, he is in loss, what he means by that is, he is in destruction. Halaka. Halak actually literally means violent death. You know, there's maut, that's death. But halak or halak is violent death, like a death in a car accident or, you know, a vicious kind of death. So he's putting himself, setting himself up from this for this vicious end. وَقَالَ الْفَرَّاءُ عُقُوبَ. And Farra says that this is a terrible ending. Uquba means a consequence, an ending that is scary for others to watch. In other words, one's end, that when other people see this, I don't want to end up like that. And you use his uquba as an example among yourself. You say, you know, you remember what happened to him? You don't want to go down that road, that kind of thing. So this is uquba. Then Ibn Zayd rahimahullah, he says, لَفِي شَرْ. لَفِي خُسْر here implies لَفِي شَرْ, that he is immersed in evil. Because the ultimate loss of the human being is his engrossment in evil deeds. We read something from Ash-Shaqqiti rahimahullah. لفظ الإنسان وإن كان منفردا فإن ألفه جعلته للجنس. The word al-insan, even though it's singular, it has been used for all humanity, generally speaking. Then we come to a very, very important comment that is made by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, and it's so powerful that it's even quoted by Mufti Muhammad Shafi'i in his Urdu tafsir, Ma'arif al-Qur'an. The translation of which is also available in English. It's not the best English, so if you can read Urdu, read the Urdu tafsir, Ma'arif al-Quran. But those of you who don't have access to that language, at least something of the English is available. What is this comment that is so beautiful that I'm referring to by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah? He says that humanity is kept from accepting reality, accepting the truth of this deen, by two obstacles. There are two obstacles that keep human beings from saving themselves. Now, what is the path to save yourself? There are two things. Those are, in the Quran we find, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا wa. What's after wa? عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَةِ. This is what we find all over the Quran, right? They believe and they act. They believe and they act. Even though we haven't talked in detail what Iman is Allah referring to, what righteous deed is Allah referring to. We're just using them as terms, as tags and phrases right now. But generally, this is the path to salvation. This is the path to save yourself and be successful in the Akhirah. The first step, Iman. The second step, action. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah argues there are two obstacles before the people that keep them from Iman and action. What are those two obstacles? He calls them Shubuhat and Shahawat. Shubuhat and Shahawat. What does that mean? Shubuhat means doubts. Shahawat means temptations, desires. So he says the two things that keep people from accepting the truth are doubts and temptations. What does he mean by that? You see, when you ask someone to accept this deen, you're asking them to give up a lot of things. You're asking them really to give up a lot of things. You know, I had a friend in college, a big guy, really like, you know, loved football. And you used to talk about Islam all the time. And I'd say, man, why don't you just accept Islam? I can't give up that pork, man. I just can't give it up. That's some good stuff. What's his obstacle? He's not in doubt. His obstacle is not doubt. He's convinced this is good. His obstacle is his temptation. Another one says, I can't give up the life of partying. I can't give up the women. I can't give up the clubs. I can't give up the drugs. I can't give up this or that or the other. These are desires. On the one hand, there's a person who says, this is right, but I cannot live by this because I'm too. The gravitational pull of temptation is just too strong for me. This is one problem. Here's another problem. Here's a person who doesn't accept, you know, what this is because he's not sure if this is the truth. You know, they'll say, how do you know yours is the only right religion? There are so many religions out there. What about them? What about all those people? They're going to just go to hell? That's what you believe? I can't accept that. That's just, I'm not sure if, how can there be just one right way? No, if there was just one right way, why wouldn't everybody just follow it? These kinds of questions come in this person's mind. And they fall into what? Doubt. This is the root of doubt. Either one of these things will keep you from the deen. Either one of these things. And by the way, most people, the problem is in doubt. Most people, the problem is temptations. And then when they fall into their temptations, shaitan comes in and adds a new virus, which is doubt. So when you call them to the deen, they say, I am in doubt, but the real problem wasn't doubt. What was it? The temptations. So in other words, there's a psychological problem and there's an intellectual problem. You could also call it a spiritual problem, a problem of the heart, which is temptation. There's an intellectual problem, a problem of the mind, which is doubt. Most people that give the excuse of the intellectual doubt, actually that's not true. That's a cover, that's a facade. The real problem is their hearts have desires. And they don't want to give up their desires. And to cover that up, they make all kinds of intellectual excuses. And when you get rid of all of them, the truth comes out that it was really their desire. I don't want to change. You know, I don't want to change. This is his, sad state that he doesn't want to come out of. Now, why mention this in the midst of this surah? You see, at the end, Allah says, "Alladhina amanu, illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat." But He mentioned two more things, didn't He? Watawasaw bilhaq, watawasaw bilsabr. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah argues, watawasaw bilhaq, truth is the removal of what? Doubt. Truth is the weapon against doubt. So, watawasi bilhaq gets rid of one obstacle. And what was the other obstacle? Shahawat, temptations, desires. To fight against those desires, knowing the truth is not enough, what must you have? The strength to not fall into them. The strength to hold back, to control yourself. Where does that come from? وَتَوَاصَوْ بِي أَصَّبِ. You see how beautifully those two obstacles that keep people from Iman and أَعْمَالَ الصَّالِحَ, they are mentioned in وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ and وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ. This is the comment that I felt was very, very important for us to understand. Now we're going to look at some other commentary. I'm going to go just through my notes so I don't miss anything, inshallah ta'ala. The first comment, just about this ayah. You see, in these two ayat, Allah Azza wa Jalla has depicted a very powerful reality. And one element of that is that human beings are so preoccupied with their personal problems. You know, Allah says human beings are in loss, right? But it's, you know, we're thinking about the hellfire and the day of judgment and all of that. But even the way Allah created the human being in this earth, before He has also said, we've already studied, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. We created the human being, no doubt, in toil, in labor. Even the kafir has to work hard. You gotta, you know, work 40 hours, 50 hours to get a paycheck and barely survive, barely make an income. That's their state too. It's not easy for anyone. So even, you know, and there are people in the world who are Muslim or non-Muslim that barely get food to eat, or they see their children starving and they see all kinds of oppression. So it's not like for the kuffar, all the kuffar, this world is Jannah also. They're also in loss, as even in worldly terms. They suffer a lot of problems.